another top Al-Qaida operative killed in a hail of gunfire, this time in Somalia. RaceWire's reports, and a warning, some of the images in this story are graphic.
It was apparently a navigational error that led to the death of one of the FBI's most wanted terrorists. Fazul Abdullah Mohammed, also known as Harun Fazul, was in this SUV with another militant when they got lost and accidentally came upon a security checkpoint in Mogadishu last Tuesday night. A gunfight ensued and both men in the SUV were killed. DNA tests later confirmed one was Fazul Mohammed, who had a $5 million FBI bounty on his head. Mohammed spent 13 years on the agency's most wanted list for orchestrating the 1998 U.S. Embassy bombings in Kenya and Tanzania that killed 224 people, including 12 Americans. He was also one of the founders of Al-Shabaab, the Al-Qaeda affiliate in Somalia, and his death is considered a significant blow to its operations in East Africa.
I think it's the removal of a problem, a person that was causing death and destruction to the people of Somalia, the region, and the world.
Fazul Mohammed is the third major Al-Qaeda leader to be killed in the last 6 weeks. Ilyas Kashmiri, who was implicated in the 2008 Mumbai attacks, is believed to have died during a June 3rd U.S. drone strike in Pakistan. This followed the killing of Osama bin Laden by Navy SEALs during a raid in Abbottabad, Pakistan, a month earlier.
For more, we turn to Juan Carlos Zarate, who served as Deputy National Security Advisor for Combating Terrorism in the Bush administration. He's now a senior advisor with the Center for Strategic and International Studies. And Juan Carlos, with some regularity over the last decade, the Al-Qaeda number two in a specific country would be killed, or the Al-Qaeda number three overall would be killed. How big a deal is the killing of this man?
This is important in the context of Al-Qaeda leadership in East Africa. Harun Fazul, as he was often referred to, was the senior leader and general for Al-Qaeda in East Africa. He was the link to the Al-Shabaab movement, the domestic militant group in Somalia, the key link to the global movement, ties historically back to the founding of Al-Qaeda, responsible for the 1998 embassy bombings attack, the 2002 Mombasa attack. I mean, this was really a key operational and strategic figure for Al-Qaeda. So his loss is a major loss for Al-Qaeda's connections in East Africa. It doesn't end the threat, certainly, from what we know in East Africa or from Al-Qaeda writ large, but it certainly is a major blow to the movement.
What is Al-Shabaab?
Al-Shabaab is a local militant group that has aligned itself ideologically and strategically with Al-Qaeda. It really emerged in earnest after the Ethiopian invasion of Somalia in 2006, gathering enthusiasm, supporters to fight the Ethiopians. But in many ways, they are extremist Islamist militants. They're currently fighting the transitional federal government. They have ties directly with Al-Qaeda, and they have started to train Westerners. We've seen this, for example, with Americans who've traveled to Somalia. And so these are a dangerous bunch. They've killed a number of Somali officials, including the interior minister last week. And so this is a dangerous part of the jihadi universe in East Africa.
So though the killing was accidental, the current government in Mogadishu and its army would have wanted to kill this man.
Absolutely. This man was wanted not just by the United States, but by the Somalis, by the Kenyans, by the Tanzanians. This is somebody who was responsible for the deaths of hundreds of Africans and continued to perpetuate attacks in the region. And so this is somebody who was wanted in the region. And I think the Somalis and the Kenyans celebrated when they found out who they had gotten.
Well, those embassy attacks for many Americans would have been the first time, perhaps along with the attack on the coal, they would have heard the term Al-Qaeda. What's Al-Shabaab and its Al-Qaeda connection been up to since those embassy bombings in 1998?
Well, you have Harun Fazul, and up until a couple of years ago, his counterpart Saleh Nabhan, another key Al-Qaeda leader in East Africa, organizing continuously, training and plotting in East Africa and the region. We had the 2002 Mombasa attacks on the hotel, the attempted bring down of the Israeli aircraft with surface-to-air missiles, which didn't succeed, fortunately. We also had the recent attacks in Uganda on the World Cup crowd, people who were celebrating and watching the World Cup. Harun Fazul is suspected to be behind, to have been behind that. And so there have been not only international attacks, but also attacks there in Somalia that the Al-Shabaab movement has been behind. And Harun Fazul is dangerous and was dangerous because he was not only the link to Al-Qaeda proper, but also was a master trainer, strategist, and manipulator. And he was great at evading capture until he was caught just recently.
When a group like al-Shabaab loses a leader of this stature, what happens? I mean, there's not an official formula for succession. What happens inside the group?
Well, unfortunately, the al-Shabaab movement has other leaders who are positioned internally within Somalia. I think the loss of Harun Fazul represents more to the global movement a catastrophe in terms of their presence in East Africa. The local group will continue to fight. They're continuing to fight the transitional federal government. They're continuing to commit suicide operations. There was just an attack on a checkpoint. And so the group itself will continue, and there's leadership there. The real question is, does it form part of this global universe of al-Qaeda affiliates and lily pads, as I call them? And without somebody like Harun Fazul with long-standing ties to al-Qaeda core and leadership, those ties are weakened, and it becomes more difficult for that group to serve as a global platform. And so the al-Shabaab will continue, unfortunately, and it will be a threat. But I think without Harun Fazul, it becomes less of a global player.
Also dead recently, as we mentioned earlier, one of the plotters behind the Mumbai attacks in 2008, what do we know about the death of Ilyas Kashmiri and his importance?
Well, the death of Ilyas Kashmiri has perhaps gone under the radar screen. Incredibly important killing in terms of the war on terror. This was a figure who was a high-level al-Qaeda operative operating in Pakistan, was the key senior link between al-Qaeda and some of the Kashmiri militant groups. He ran a group called Huji, which was involved in the Kashmiri militant activity, was behind the Mumbai attacks, was behind certain other attacks. And he was a key strategist and operational leader. And so losing him in the wake of the loss of Osama bin Laden is a major blow to the groups in western Pakistan that are starting to align with each other.
Not so much for the soldiers, but if you're, for want of a better term, middle management in these groups through this crescent that runs from East Africa into Central Asia, do you think twice about taking on a senior leadership role? Is it hot for these guys now?
Well, I'm not quite sure about the motivation. I think these guys are motivated regardless for the cause, but I think certainly they're laying low. They understand that there's quite a bit of counterterrorism pressure now in the wake of the Osama bin Laden killing. And so there is no doubt key leadership going to ground both in western Pakistan and around the world. You've seen, for example, attempts by the U.S. to go after folks like Anwar al-Awlaki, the Yemeni American cleric who's a part of the al-Qaeda group in Yemen. And so what you're seeing now, I think, is a real global push by the United States and our allies to go after key al-Qaeda leaders to, in the words of John Brennan, the assistant to President Obama, break the back of al-Qaeda's leadership.
Juan Carlos Zarate, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Ray.